There was once a weaver who filled her fine silk brocades with flowers and birds that seemed so real they almost quivered. She and her three sons never went hungry, for when she brought her wares to the marketplace, everyone would gasp at their beauty and grasp for their purses. One day, after she had sold all her brocades, she walked past the stalls in the marketplace with her pocket full of money. Her eye was suddenly caught by a small painting, half hidden behind other wares. She picked up the painting to admire it more closely. Her eyes traveled over the tiny image of a fine white house surrounded by fields of red flowers. A crystal pool shimmered in the sunlight beside the house, and the dancing fish seemed so lifelike they almost moved. A lazy river wound its way about the edges of the field. Cattle and sheep grazed peacefully. She could almost feel the painting's warm sunlight on her face. Oh, how she longed to be in such a place. Without considering for even a moment, she reached into her pocket and spent all of her hard-earned money on the precious painting. Smiling, she set off for home with the treasure pressed to her heart under her jacket. Her three sons greeted her when she arrived at her humble thatched cottage at the foot of the mountains.
"How was your luck today, mother?"
inquired the eldest. "I had great luck," she answered with a grin.
"Then have you brought us special foods to eat?"
asked the second, licking his lips at the thought of expensive sweets. "I have brought you a feast for your eyes," she said, drawing forth the tiny painting from her jacket. Her two older sons grumbled their disappointment, but her youngest, delighting in his mother's pleasure, gazed at the painting and said, "It is an exquisite picture." "Oh, if we could only live in such a place," the weaver sighed. Her two older sons muttered, "Stop dreaming. We could never afford to live in such a place." Her youngest son saw the shadow of sadness pass over the weaver's face. He said, "Mother, make a brocade that looks like this painting. While you work, it will be as though you are there beside the shimmering pond." The weaver set about instantly to weave the image of the tiny painting. She immersed herself in the image, and so great was her joy that she worked without stopping. She used the finest threads of silver and gold. She wove all day, each day, and at night she burned pine branches to make enough light to weave longer. She wove only this picture, and soon had nothing to take to market.
"Make something that you can quickly sell at the market, or we will have to cut firewood to earn some money," complained the two older brothers. "You are wasting too much time on this brocade."
But the weaver could not stop her wonderful brocade. The youngest son calmed his two brothers and said,
"Do not fret. I will cut the wood we need so that mother can finish her brocade."
The weaver wove for 1 year without stopping, and her eyes began to water as she worked. She wove her tears into the crystal waters of the pond. After another year, her eyes began to shed tears of blood, and these tears she wove into the red flowers swaying in the fields. At the end of the third year, the weaver was almost blind, but the brocade was done. The sun hung like a red plum in the sky, and the house stood white and welcoming. Cattle and sheep grazed in fields of graceful grasses. She brought her work outside to admire it in the sunlight. Suddenly, a great wind came and whisked it out of her hands. She shrieked with alarm as the brocade swept high above her head and flew off toward the east. Her grief was beyond measure, and she fell to the earth in a faint. Her sons carried her into the house and laid her on the bed. "Mother," they cried, "what can we do?" When at last she opened her eyes, she said to her sons, "Please, find my brocade, or I will surely die." The oldest son set off first, walking toward the east. After a while, he came upon a white-haired woman, sitting in front of a stone house. Beside her was a stone horse, its neck stretched out as if to eat the red berries on a bush.
"Good day, old woman," said the boy. "Have you seen a brocade fly by?"
"Indeed I have," said the old woman.
"And I know all about it, too. Oh, the fairies of Sun Mountain have stolen it from your mother. They have flown it away to copy it, for it is far more beautiful than anything they have ever made. Oh, you can get it back for your mother, but there are several things that you must do. First, knock out your two front teeth. I will put them in this toothless horse's mouth. He will come to life and carry you to Sun Mountain. Oh, the journey will be difficult. He will carry you across Fire Mountain. And although the flames will lick you like cats, you must not complain of the heat. He will carry you across an icy sea. And although the cold ocean spray will pierce your face like needles, you must not utter a sound. Once you have arrived at Sun Mountain, the fairies will give you back the brocade."
The boy's face paled at the thought of knocking out his teeth.
"Well," said the old woman, noticing his hesitation, "I see this is more than you are willing to do. So take this box of gold to your family as a gift from the fairies and live well."
The oldest son took the gold and headed for home. When he arrived at the crossroads, he thought, "Well, if I bring all this gold home, I must share it four ways. If I keep it for myself, I will never have to work." And he turned toward the city and did not come home. 2 months passed. The weaver grew weaker with each passing day. She begged her second oldest son to go forth and find her brocade. He set out toward the east, and when he met the white-haired woman, he too refused to make the journey to Sun Mountain. She gave him a box of gold from the fairies, and he headed home. Like his older brother, the second son decided to keep the gold for himself and set off for the city. Meanwhile, at the cottage, the weaver grew paler and paler. She cried so often she could barely see. "I will find your brocade," said the youngest son, "since I cannot bear your sorrow any longer." He walked east, and at last he arrived at the stone house. The old woman smiled and said,
"I suppose you are looking for a brocade that has flown by this way?"
"Yes, I am," said the boy. "I would do anything to find it."
"Perhaps and perhaps not," said the old woman,
and she carefully explained the tasks that he must perform. Without hesitation, the boy knocked out his two front teeth. In an instant, they were in the horse's mouth, and the boy mounted the huge steed, who shuddered from stone to flesh and pawed the ground. The horse ate the red berries and galloped in a cloud of dust over the hills and valleys. Suddenly, the boy felt a scorching heat on his skin. His hot face flushed red from the glowing flames of Fire Mountain as he traveled over its top. He gripped the reins.
and continued on. He galloped over the icy sea, shivering and shuddering as frigid water splashed and froze on his back. His tears became icicles and pierced his cheeks, but he did not utter a complaint. At last, they came to Sun Mountain, where warmth and light drenched the sky. The horse slowed to a walk and stepped onto the shore. Before them was a fine palace, with towers and banners and gardens all around. The boy jumped off the horse and entered the central hall of the palace. There he saw the fairy women sitting in a great circle about his mother's brocade. It was hung on an easel, and all the fairies were busy making brocades just like it. The boy entered, bowed low, and said, "Please, I have come for the brocade my mother made with her heart, hands, blood, and tears. If I do not return it to her, she will surely die." The fairies all nodded and said, "You may have it back when we are finished copying it." To make the work go faster, the fairies hung a huge pearl overhead. The pearl shed a luminous glow, and the fairies worked through the night while the boy slept on the floor, waiting. At last, all the fairies had gone to sleep, except for one beautiful sprite in red. She sighed with dismay as she looked at her own copy of the brocade. "Oh, my copy does not compare to the original. What a beautiful place. I wish I could live there." Since no one was looking, she embroidered a tiny picture of herself in the original brocade and went to sleep. Just then, the boy woke up, and quick as a blink, he grabbed the brocade and ran. He leaped onto the horse's back, and in a flash they were back at the stone house. The white-haired woman took the two front teeth from the horse and put them back in the boy's mouth. Then, for his bravery, she gave the boy a pair of magic deerskin shoes. With one step and a wish, he was back at his mother's door. "Mother, mother," he cried, "get up and see! I have the brocade!" The weaver lifted her head from her pillow, and a smile spread over her face as she rose to greet her son. She blinked away the tears and clearly saw the brocade. "Oh, let's take it out into the sunlight," she said, barely able to contain her joy. She spread the brocade on the ground and was admiring it when suddenly it began to move. It floated upright and began to quiver and expand until it became the world around. The weaver gasped in amazement. There before her was a great grassy field of red flowers, a shimmering pond, a lazy winding river, and the fine white house. She and her son stepped into the field and were walking toward the white house when they saw a beautiful young woman dressed all in red coming toward them. It was the fairy who had sewn herself into the brocade. The weaver's son married the woman in red, and they all lived in great happiness in the white house, enjoying the bounty and beauty of their surroundings for many, many years. One spring day, two old ragged beggars came along. They were the two brothers who had squandered their wealth in the city. Seeing the fine white house, they plotted to steal from its owner. As they crept across the field, oh, they saw their own mother, now white-haired with age, walking in the garden with their younger brother and a beautiful woman in red, their cheeks flushed with embarrassment. Ashamed to face them, the brothers slunk away down the road and never troubled their door again.